All right, it's 10 o'clock on the dot. So good morning, welcome. Thank you for joining us for another of NWeLearn's summer webinar. And my name is Anna Thompson. I'm gonna start with some housekeeping items. I am the current NWeLearn chair and host for this webinar. With us today are two of our board members who will be helping moderate this session, Weiwei Zhang and Nina Fox. This session will be recorded and made available on the NWeLearn website in the coming week. And you can access that at nwelearn.org/webinars. We'll be enabling automatic captions, and you can turn them on or off using the caption or CC button, depending what you're using. So, okay, they are now enabled. And this morning we have Todd Conaway, instructional designer at University of Washington, Bothell, who will be talking on the topic of show me your work, or yes, you need a portfolio. So without further ado, here's Todd.
Thanks, Anna. So I taught middle school for a while, so I should be able to kind of corral this group and make sure nobody gets out of hand, even with Ray just joining us. I'd like to know who's in this group. So if you could just tell me kind of, since we're only five or six of us, actually Nina and Weiwei, this includes the two of you and Anna, what do you do? Who's your audience? Yeah, and Anna, we'll start with you.
So I am a learning and access designer and at University of Washington, Bothell. And I help faculty and many times students as well and staff with questions, technology, how to do things. Many times the solution doesn't have to be technology related.
Excellent. Nina, what do you do? Who's your audience?
I am an LMS administrator at the University of Oregon, and my audience are faculty, students, staff, instructional designers, anything having to do with course development, both academically and professionally.
Okay. Excellent. Weiwei, who's your audience? What do you do?
I'm from Oregon State University. I'm a student resource system product manager at Academic Technology. I do a lot of faculty development and collaborating with our eCampus colleagues and CTL. We run faculty development workshops and of course support them with anything that's technology related in teaching.
Nice. Cassidy, who's your audience? What do you do?
So I am a manager in CTS in ITS at the University of Idaho. So I'm a manager of collaboration and classroom technology services. And I'm also an instructor for the College of Education.
Excellent. Cool. Linda, who's your audience? What do you do?
I'm a faculty member in the College of Education at George Fox University. I mostly work in the area of math teacher preparation. I also teach in our adult degree completion programs, mostly statistics and research methods, and currently have a passion for data-informed decision-making.
Excellent, excellent. Ray?
Hello, I'm an instructional designer. I've actually done contract work in a few different states and currently in the middle of interviews, a number of which in the Pacific Northwest. So I found this group 6 to 12 months ago, and I've seen some really great presentations. So
nice.
In the idea of yours and this one, I'm like, wow, another great one looks like with portfolios. My teaching experience in the past has been in mostly like applied health sciences, namely anatomy and physiology, even first aid, CPR. So the idea of alternative assessments isn't maybe as easy and immediate, but I think essential. So that's why I showed up today.
Excellent, excellent. Well, I can tell you as a fellow instructional designer, having a portfolio of the things that you can do that people can go look at is super helpful.
Yes.
All right.
Another essential thing. Yeah.
Yeah. Alicia, who's your audience? What do you do?
Hi, yeah, I'm an instructional designer at Idaho State University. And my audience is mainly faculty. I work directly with them, but obviously always advocating for the student perspective. So we build their classes, help with technology, whatever they kind of need help with their online courses. We use the Quality Matters rubric. So I'm looking forward to this presentation specifically for the standards that have to do with active learning and students, you know, engaging with content in that way. So.
Okay. Wow, interesting. All right, so I'm an instructional designer and my audience is like mostly faculty, but over the years, I've just done a gazillion like student focused, like how to use the LMS type back in the day. How to use the LMS, but all kinds of other tools over the years. So, but truthfully, in today's world with the internet, isn't everybody your audience to some degree, right? Future employers, that's why you have some LinkedIn account or something. I mean, who knows? So there is your audience could be pretty broad, depending on what you have and where it is. So I would just like you to encourage all of you to, if you have a question, now's the time to ask it. And that means like anytime in the next 56 minutes or whatever we have. You can ask it in chat. I'll see it and try to answer it. If I keep stumbling along and not answering it, raise your hand or just unmute yourself and say something. But please ask questions in the time and space that they occur for you. Don't wait till the end. I can manage those things. So what I'm gonna do today is tell you a story, show you some stuff, and then we'll be done. And during that time, I'm gonna ask you three different questions, and I hope that you participate as you just did. I don't wanna be forced to call on you, so please be good, active participants. And it looks like Betsy is in the room. Betsy, can you hear me? Okay, I tell you what, Betsy, in the chat, if you might put your what you do and who your audience is for your work. Ah, excellent. Okay. I am going to go ahead and start then and see how it goes. So the title of this is Show Me Your Work. Part of that comes from some math anxieties that I have and you know, having always had math teachers that would say, show me your work, that stuck in my head because there was an emotion attached to it, right? Like I was very emotional when they said, Todd, show us your work on the chalkboard. I would freak out. So anytime somebody tells me to show me the work, I have this emotional reaction. But it's important to start anything with a good story or a story. I'm gonna tell you a story. So in about 1984, I started at a small liberal arts college by the name of Prescott College. And it was known for its commitment to experiential learning and environmental issues. And at the end of my first year, one of the classes that I made up with a fellow student was, we thought we'd go to the Redwood Forest and take photographs of all the things we saw there, and we would write about them, and we would return back to Arizona with this big portfolio of our experiences. And this was back in the day when you took a picture, you actually had to take this little plastic canister into a drugstore or something. And they would like, in a week later, you'd get this package back from them and it would have your pictures in it. So you took, if you can imagine a time where when you took a picture, you couldn't see it. That's when this was happening back in those days. So we did, we went up there and this is kind of what it looked like, right? So we wrote handwritten words, like with a pen on paper, and we wrote words on paper, and then we took these pictures and we waited a week till we got them back, and we glued them onto these pages, and we had this whole book of stuff. I'm not going to go through this whole site, but the long-term effect of that experience was that 20 years later, I was taking kids to the Redwoods and around, and we would write about it, and then we would put pictures on things and make these journals or portfolios of work. So there I was at Prescott College. At the end of the first year, I took this trip to the Redwoods. We made this cool portfolio. And the following year, I went to a conference that had a fella named the wife of a guy named Willie Unsold, who worked at Evergreen State College here in Washington. And he was known for his outdoor pursuits. And he passed away literally on Mount Rainier here in Washington. But for his efforts in the field of outdoor education, he was given the Kurt Hahn Award. And I bring Kurt Hahn up here because Kurt Hahn was the founder of Outward Bound, if you're familiar with that. But he also had a lot to say about school and how we go to school and the things that are important in schooling. So if you're interested in the field of education, Kurt Hahn is a great person to be aware of as an educator. So I go to this conference. This was back in 1985. I think it was in Mutus, Connecticut. And this award was given to this guy. And it was a really great experience for me because I, at like 22, was surrounded by all these like great educators. People I like, they were all way older than me and they'd been in the field, but it really had an impact on me. And what was really cool was that 30 years later, after that experience, I got to do a presentation at Prescott College for one of the regional conferences for that group. So it was really cool. And that presentation is actually linked here on this site, which I will share the link with if you haven't already gone there. I'll share the link with you at the end of this presentation. But I tell that story partly because I went to a school that had a lot of investment in journals and portfolios. And so the manifestation of the work that you did to make it visible has long been a part of kind of who I am and my work. So at that level, I'm not afraid to show you the work. If you ask me math questions and say, show me the work, I'm going to freak out. So that's my little story about kind of Todd and this idea of portfolios and where it came from and kind of a cool experience I had where I was able to, many years later, actually kind of be a part of a group on the other end as a presenter, not as a young student. So anyway, that's my story. And now we'll get on kind of with the rest of the stuff here. So here's why I'm doing this and why it's important to me and why I've been kind of saying this for some time. I think we learn from our peers. And as an instructional designer, one thing that I know is that the walls between faculty offices might as well be, 8 feet thick, right? There's just not a lot of communication between faculty, and it's not just faculty, it's colleges within universities, it's divisions within colleges. There's just a lot of siloing. So I'm really interested in faculty bridging that distance in ways that work. We all know that there's great ideas out there and we are responsible, you and I and everybody, we have good ideas and we just need to share them because that's how somebody will find them. If you never share it, nobody's gonna find it. If you don't send holiday cards, you're not gonna get any. If you gotta share to receive to some degree. I think that I was a high school English teacher for 10 years. So writing is something that I enjoy doing. Someday I'll get better at it, but I'm trying to write some things. In fact, more recently, my work like this has become trying to really tell a story rather than put things in a PowerPoint slide. So I'm typing out sentences rather than notes. And that's an interesting thing. Also, I think that one of the things that we all can do is explore this technology and decide how it's going to work for us, if it's a good thing, if it's a bad thing. And if you're not exploring some of those options, you know, we're not going to make progress. We have to get out there in front of the technology to make good decisions. So those are kind of some of the reasons why I think this topic is important, and showing your work in on paper or on a website or in a video on YouTube, all of those things address those issues. So what I'm going to do now is just go through some websites, and I'm going to just kind of show you the qualities of them. And if you have any questions about any of these, please let me know, either in the chat or either in the chat or just start talking. Fair enough? Okay. All righty then. So this first site is by a biology instructor at a community college. I started at a community college when all of the probationary portfolios had to be turned in a three-ring binder. I was working with faculty who were doing amazing work digitally that I knew could not be placed in the three-ring binder. I started advocating for moving towards something different, anything other than just the printed option. And down the road, it took some years, but that became more available to faculty. So one of the things that Joanne had done was very simply, and this is at a real practical level, Ray, you know, this is kind of, in a way, this is show me what you've done as an instructional designer. This is a faculty answering a very clear question from her dean. Show me the things that are in your portfolio that you've done. And so she did. So she took all of the headings that were in the three ring binder, the little page dividers with the colored things, if you can remember those. And she took those things and she placed them in a website. It's a super practical kind of way to address one element of the digital world we all live in and some of the things we're asked to do professionally. For her, what this particular thing did, which was on a free WordPress site, which is a website, a web editor, it allowed her to begin to learn what was possible on the web. And in this next instance, I'm going to show you another faculty who kind of took that one step further. So he bought his own domain. So it doesn't have the .wordpress.com after his name. So he bought his own domain, but he also added some other things. And in this case, he added videos. And they're not videos Integrity or Panopto or the kind of tool du jour of a university. He was able to put them on YouTube, which made it really easy to place them in some other space, like this particular blog. So in this case, he has all of those same CV, teaching philosophy, samples of student work. He addressed all those same kind of needed issues that they were asking him to demonstrate as a new faculty, but he also kind of moved out even further and I know that today this doesn't seem like such a big deal, but for many, you know, 10 years ago, moving in from kind of your Panopto university supported video tool into YouTube was pretty risky. Like people were like, I don't want people to see me on a video. So there were a lot of challenges back in the day. But this was a great example of somebody taking a pretty simple idea initially, which was to digitize his probationary portfolio and move it into some other space. And you can see here that he actually even had further, he had a blog that he wrote for his class with like various updates. So that is Joanne and Sal's work here. The next example I have here is actually from a faculty right here at the University of Washington, Bothell. So her website looks a little more modern, right? Looks a little more flashy. She doesn't have, this is not like a probationary portfolio for her. This has, and you can see this across the navigation at the top, she has her writing, she has things that she does as speaking engagements, she has a podcast, she has resources about the topic that she teaches, right? And so she's using hers, not necessarily to address the requirements of a faculty portfolio, to gain tenure or whatever. This was actually just done all on her own, where she just thought she has something to say, so she's gonna share it. So it's a kind of a different way of doing this work and for a different reason and for a different audience, right? The first two I showed you were really made specifically for their deans to say, this is what I do. This one is just more broad in the audience. Okay, so here's my question to you, because when you put stuff on YouTube or when you put it on a blog or when you put it out there on the web, as we all know, for better or worse, you can often reply or say something to that person who has posted the video on YouTube or posted a blog post somewhere. So my question is, should a portfolio that's out there on the web be something that people can respond to? Because that can be kind of dangerous. And I'll use that last example here. So Jennifer, she teaches environmental classes and she teaches environmental grief and loss. And as you can imagine, the notion of kind of people grieving for the environment in some political circles hasn't gone over that well. So she got a lot of pushback from some folks in her presentations or her writing about things. And one of the things that she and I talked about at length was the notion of putting work out there and allowing people to respond to it, given that some people may not like what you're saying. So when you put work out there, should it be something people can respond to? So that's my question. Anybody have any thoughts?
Yeah, I had a question that was, I was waiting to see where, mostly how you were presenting your portfolio, Todd, mm-hmm. But it's directly related to this question. And I've been to some of the, like Anna Thompson, I've seen, I think, your presentations. And so I'm familiar with some of the people here, even though I'm an outsider. But my question, what I was thinking about was, I was noticing, okay, he's going to show portfolio. And you talked about way back. I remember I've been in a dark room, your own Walgreens. But I've kind of let it go as an instructional designer for almost 10 years now because I've seen a progression. So this thing about, well, there's these statements that it's not about the technology and you always, we're instructional designers more so. There's all these conversations about quality communication and your statement or actually your phrase in terms of you got to share your work. If you're showing your work, you're sharing your work if you want to have collaboration. So with all those big communication expression issues, I want to get to the technologies that are used. You know, so I started trying to do websites and integrate them in early LMSs like Blackboard. And then WordPress came along. And then, you know, blogs came along. And so one thing, the tools that are out there now, in my last contract, I was at Arizona State University at a time when they were doing a huge digital transformation. And so there was just tools everywhere. But I think where we're at on tools now, and that's the question of how should we share it and what's going to happen when we share it. And past the WordPress, and maybe there's a few others that are similar, maybe Microsoft's got a tool. There's the collaborative tools, which aren't really blogging per se or website, but they can be used as such the right way. And that's our collaboration platforms like Slack and now Teams.
Right.
But also, you know, the Google Docs, then Suite, now Workspace. And, you know, and you take sites, for example, and by nature, that is interactive. And it's almost like conversations about your conversation. So the whole way that's set up. And so also the idea of putting things on YouTube, that platform, and like I say, I'm saying this because I want to think that I think things should go towards this tool, but the nature of what they present. I've always been looking at your questions and how it's going to happen with, well, as I still have a WordPress account for 5 years now, I haven't used much, of how do you gauge and maybe moderate your sharing, your collaboration, your conversations. And so when I see tools like WordPress, there's two things that come to mind, and that's anyone, my grandfather, anyone being able to get in a community and maybe where appropriate share, versus when you have tools like Dreamweaver, Wayback, and then WordPress. But now the more, I'd call them further intuitive or further multi-conversational tools. And so, you know, it's not about the tools, right? It's about all these things. And even the few that you showed are really from looking at someone's whole life and their professionally, it's really about that. But that progression of tools, I think, can have a big effect in terms of how you're able to share, how you're able to build community, and how to have critique, but maybe not, you know, condemnation,
right.
or nice, those in, all those right? in-betweens. It can happen, yeah.
So, I mean, I think that the evolution is from kind of the web started as a very one-directional tool, right? It was like TV, you watched it. The web 2.0, remember that? Like it was interactive, you could participate, you could co-create, you know? And we're still kind of in that space more or less, right? I think everybody's decided maybe we shouldn't have screamed and yelled at one another so much when we were interacting and tried to be a little more positive. But you know, I do agree with some of these other comments and yours that I guess the good thing is that most tool makers out there, whoever they are, recognize that your ability as the creator to choose whether you're going to turn it, make it public or not, allow comments or not, that's kind of the key. And I mean, I have a gazillion unlisted videos on my YouTube channel. That are really just not, I don't want people just randomly commenting on them. So I don't make them public, you know, but you usually have the choice. And so I guess part of me is like, I would love to see people say in my work, wow, hey, good idea, Todd. What I would like is somebody far away to maybe bump into something I did someday and say, hey, that's a good idea, Todd. Have you ever thought about this? And whatever they share with me is something that I hadn't heard yet, right? And that they're offering improvement to what I had done, you know? So, and I think that the only way that really happens on the web via time and physical distance is by allowing other people to in some way interact with what you've created. Yeah. Okay.
I'm some of the other comments coming in. So
yeah. I'm going to move on. I think it's something that for you, Race, particularly if you're building a portfolio like for your work or doing that, is it's a good question to wonder about, because in WordPress, for example, you can click a button to allow comments or not. And it's that simple, right? Like you have control over that, which makes that pretty easy. Okay, so speaking of YouTube, right? So here's one of the faculty here, right here at Bothell. He's got a few videos out there, right? So he has gone this route. Not all of them have comments. He has chosen to make public his work, which is a long conversation, as anybody in instructional design knows. If you know, primarily working with faculty who are in, you know, kind of a LMS environment, most things don't get out. Here it's taking something that's out and putting it back in, which is a way different model of kind of behaving. And I show you this because, as you have seen, I'm sure, educators are moving some content out in a more public sphere. And this is showing me Chris's work. You know, that, I mean, the name of this thing is Show Me Your Work. Here's his work, right? It might be too much to consume for Todd. Like, I don't even know what his topics are, but he's demonstrating his ability, not just to make a video, but he's demonstrating his understanding of healthcare and health topics, because that's his work, is teaching healthcare courses. So there's a lot of spaces to do showing people work. At Prescott College, we used a lot of journals. And I think by nature, I'm kind of a reflective person. So I tend to like faculty wondering about things, right? And there are portfolios out there that include videos that are content related. They include resumes. They include things your dean needs to see in order to fulfill tenure-related issues. But they also can just simply wonder about the work of teaching, right? And those are my favorite kinds. So I'm going to show you just a couple examples here of those types. This is Elisa Cooper from the Maricopa Community College System down in Arizona. And this site just has, she has been doing this a long time and thinks very seriously about things that happen in classrooms, in digital classrooms. She thinks very deeply about things that happen at universities to educators, to instructional designers, to teaching and learning centers. And she puts it out there for people to read and wonder about as well. So this site has, this 6 hours of accountability, that was actually one of the Maricopa Community Colleges. They had faculty basically demonstrate that they were doing particular types of work, and they were holding them sort of accountable for some of these things. And so she put out her stuff just publicly. The next one is another woman who has just done amazing work in the digital landscape. And I guess part of this presentation is a bunch of links that is on this website. Because these are people who inspire me just all the time. So Lisa teaches history classes. She has an incredibly rich history in the world of digital learning, teaching and learning in general. And her site, as you can kind of see here, it has the classic, you know, CV, it's got writings of various things, it's got photographs from trips, she's got topical things like the LMS and history. So she has a really interesting navigation set up here that's really broad. You know, it's not just a particular course. So those are those two kind of more reflective, where there's just a lot of stuff on there that, a lot of stuff on there that should, my dog is barking. The next one here is somebody who is both an instructional designer and an instructor. So Sean Michael Morris has this site, which has, again, kind of the CV. He's got some particular topics, but if you look through the blog part of this, much of it is writing that, and he's just a prolific writer. So a lot of these are longer, bigger articles. But he does a lot of thinking about teaching and learning. And I guess when, like for me as an instructional designer, when I think of my work is with faculty, it's with students, it's like doing things that the university's asking me to do. But there's also a real, and I think I learned this as a high school English teacher, that my job was to communicate English related things and understandings to the people in the classrooms that I taught in. But I felt like over the years, I learned that I also had a deep need, and my responsibility was to change and improve what we were all doing. And to that end, people like Sean Michael Morris, I think they really are willing to step out of kind of just the job and share more broadly their thoughts about teaching and learning. And a lot of times they're not doing the same thing that was happening last week. They're, in this case, pretty progressive. So I think when I think of showing your work to somebody, it's not just work about biology 101, but it's your thoughts about something perhaps more deeper, right? Okay, this time we have another question. And in order to get done on time, we're gonna make these comments a little brief, but I wanna ask, because when you talk about saying things that may not align 100% with your institution's mission, when you're critical of that, when you're sharing things that are pretty heartfelt about the work you do, it's kind of personal. So my question here is, how personal should you be in a portfolio? And this time we got to keep comments a little brief, but any thoughts on being personal in this portfolio space? Personal and professional, right? I have trouble, Ron, with those. I can't blend those things very well. I'm the most non-professional person. Any other thoughts? Yeah, it's tricky, right? Because personal could just be like pictures of my family and my kids are somehow linked to my site. But then there's also the personal, like, commitment to what we are doing, what the broader scope of our work. Okay, I'm moving on. So another way that we can share the work we do, or show me your work, is, and as an instructional designer, I can't tell you how much further along the road of digital literacy we would be if only teacher of bio 101 could see teacher bio 102's course easily without having to email a dean to ask them to be added to some class, who then has to email me to actually be able to add them to a class. If we could just see what our colleagues were doing, we would be so much more literate in this world of digital stuff. I was super lucky back in Arizona to work with some faculty who just did great work in the digital landscape. And I'm gonna just show you a couple really quick examples here. This is from the Wayback Machine. So this site is not active anymore. The link on this presentation goes here. But you can see he really thought about this. All his course materials were here for his various courses. All the videos, everything. This site actually is still active, and she still, I don't think she really uses it that much anymore, but it had all of her course materials, all of the things that she was doing in her anatomy and physiology classes, all online. And that included the lectures, the Quizlets, the handouts, the PowerPoint slides, all those things were all right here. And just from the point of somebody who works in the LMS like a lot, you know, the LMS is mostly just hyperlinks, right, to things. Some are inside the LMS and some are YouTube videos or some a link to some article. When your content has a permanent link that is, you know, ellensavolini.com/anatomy101/, when it's like a permanent link, those links don't need to be changed every quarter from one place to another, right? They can be easily moved into an LMS. And I guess that's part of the story of, you know, if we all began outside where we could see one another's work, we could show each other what we do, it would be much easier to then put it in the LMS. But since everything is in an LMS, sometimes it's challenging to get it out. Intellectually too, to get it out into the wide open world. So those are a couple classes there. This is a much more modern class, right? So this, I just found this guy's classes the other day. These are way more modern looking courses, right? And there's a couple examples of, he has two different classes. And I literally just found these last week. And he, of course, also is moving not just to the one direction of here is your video, here is your stuff, but he's taking multiple people's work and pulling it into his site. And here is a brilliant example of that. So this is from a faculty, one of the founding education faculties here at the University of Washington, Bothell, from a few years back. But as you can see, this wasn't just her stuff. It wasn't just the teacher's information going one direction. She wasn't just showing me her work. She's showing me the work of her entire class, right? So in this case, it's all these students' work that are the student work that's being pulled into a single space. So I get to learn not just from the teacher of the course, but I can learn from the students or share in their thoughts or their experiences. And I think that's a beautiful way to move. Some of these, you know, I think tools like WordPress can be used at their very most basic level and are by default 100% accessible. You know, there are a gazillion tools out there that have accessibility issues. Any educator's decision to use those needs to be tempered with, hey, do you know the access, how is it accessible? And many times today, sometimes those are not, they are not. And so that is an ongoing conversation for sure. Okay, so last question before we get to the end of this. I took this from is it good to have your stuff out there? I guess I tried to rephrase it a little bit because I get pushback from some faculty about putting work out there on the web, particularly student work, because they'll bring up FERPA and they're gonna bring up all these many other issues, and legitimately so. But tell me, is it, and I'll take this since many of you are instructional designers, is it wrong to have your material that you create out there on the open web? Any thoughts on having your material out there? Is it if I put videos I make for my faculty here at Bothell and I put them out there on the wide open internet in my portfolio where I'm trying to demonstrate my work, is that wrong of me? Am I cheating the administration and the taxpayers of King County by putting stuff I make specifically for the University of Washington Bothell out there on the big internet? Any thoughts?
No. Is that okay if I unmute my mic? I think you can hear me. No, I don't see anything wrong with that. So
I don't either. But I do think there are instances where, what's the percentage of course materials for any course anywhere that live entirely their whole lives inside of an LMS? And I don't mean to berate like the confines of an LMS. It's just a simple fact. The information is contained in an LMS as opposed to somewhere else. Just by default, that is how things have evolved. I think, Linda, I think the permissions vary, right? There's all kinds of Creative Commons licensing these days, attribution. It's always nice to give credit where credit's due. And I think that for most people, that's about where that is. There is certainly Disney, for example, on YouTube, who are very vicious about how they, keep their material out of public consumption unless it's paid for at some level. So, Okay. Lastly, I'm going to take a look at a couple student portfolios. I'm not going to play this video right here, but this is, and you'll be able to see it here. Well, I think Anna shared this link. I hope all of you aren't wandering around out there on the internet clicking on all these links. There are a lot of things on this website. So this was a video I made about my daughter's experience on the web. And it's really interesting. If you think, when you watch it, I think it's like 4 minutes long. When you watch it, think about the idea of showing your work to somebody, right? And the story behind this is really interesting because tons of it is out there public as it was created, which I think is pretty interesting. Okay, I'm gonna go back in time really briefly. So here, this is Todd the educator. When I realized that some things were happening that I was never really comfortable with, thank you, Ray, for putting that link there. I saw a lot of student work that just got discarded, right? And now as a parent of two college age daughters, I recall a lot of their work I tossed into the trash can myself. So when I discovered that I could put information in a more permanent way out there for somebody to see, I did. And this was way back in, I don't know, I think 1998, maybe. So this is what it looked like. It wasn't pretty. It wasn't accessible. Well, it partly was, but it just wasn't that amazing, right? That evolved into slightly more complex spaces that had, this is a single student's work, different parts of their work, but these things allowed students to share and express what they were doing, which I think was really, I think that my daughters both, through the various tools they use, are able to understand that they can express to a broader audience and show people what they're capable of doing, both professionally and personally. Certainly Facebook, Instagram, things like that. It's at a personal level, but also kind of, you know, look at YouTube, for example. YouTube was originally just cat videos, more or less, until somebody said, let me show you how to fix this math problem or how to do this math problem. And all of a sudden, the Khan Academy or other spaces like that had more recognition. And what a great resource, right? When you can share how to unpack, you know, you get some IKEA thing in a box and you're left to try and figure out how to put it together and the directions, or you can't understand them, but you can watch somebody in a video and pause it as you go through those steps. That's huge. And some of the things that are available today, I mean, this was done in by one of my students here at the University of Washington, Bothell, in a tool called Adobe Spark, right? I mean, not only does it look nice, but it fits on your phone or tablet. It's pretty accessible by default, and it tells a great story, right? I mean, it's just a great way to experience the content. It's embeddable into your website. It looks really nice. And so that's what students can do. Any questions before I do these last two things? Anybody have any questions? Okay, so I just showed you a whole bunch of things, right? A whole bunch of things on the internet. This last thing here is a website that I made for a teacher who had been asking about, like, I need tutorials for this, or what are some options for students to create tutorials? I made this site for her, and I have to tell you, it's been used by a lot of other faculty over the last few years. And it all it is some links to examples and some links to the help pages of various tools that exist on the internet. All of them are free, that you can use right now to begin to build out a portfolio. My suggestion would be WordPress. I've been more aligned with that recently. But Ray mentioned earlier, I mean, back in the day, it literally was Dreamweaver. This was before kind of modern day website makers happened. But WordPress is a great way to get started. So all of these have examples and links to their help pages. And there's a lot of people trying to build out good resources for their products. So the help pages these days are really pretty good. So that's a link near the bottom of that page. The very last item in that page is a link to this site, which is an enormous space full of show me your work. There's literally thousands of sites here that are student created, faculty created, showing you ideas or topics or things they're interested in, or completing assignments. And I think for me personally, it's been a good experience to see just how big this picture of the internet can be. And it's helped me appreciate just how little my little space is. So what I want to show you lastly, this whole presentation is right here, right? Everything we just saw in the last 50 minutes was right here, right? When I think of, like, and I try hard like to do this, but when I think of, like, showing people my work, I have my portfolio, right? I got, like, the things I've done technically, but I also have, like, all of these conference presentations I've given over the years. I've got all these things that I've written professionally that are on various websites. I have some other weird writing. I have some like things that I've done in that DS-106 class, which is just some really weird examples of what's possible on the internet. But this thing has the stuff that I'm like had the most fun doing. I have like these weird things related to Blackboard or videos that I've created for people. I have courses that I've taught, you know, these are all classes or little courses, professional development classes. And then of course I have all my little short blogs where I try to say something intelligent. But that's how I show my work as an instructional designer. In that portfolio page, there's a resume that you can click and print super easy, but it doesn't tell really the whole story about my capabilities or what I do. At the very bottom of that page is a link to a survey that you need to fill out before the day's over. Anna had shared that link to that page I just shared. I just put it in the chat again. So there you go. When people say, show me your work, show me your portfolio, what have you done? That's what's possible. Those are all examples of people showing what they're capable of doing in classrooms, because there's videos of Saul in his classroom. There's videos of people doing all kinds of things. There's text, there's pictures, there's websites. Yeah, I think we live in a time where we can show one another who we are, what we're capable of doing in a lot of different ways. So there you go. Any questions? Yes, Ron, it's good to see you.
I just gonna say that's awesome. Thanks again.
You bet. Come on.
Hey, Hi, this is Betsy. I don't have a question, but I think, you know, the way you ended this about show me your work, to me, you're anticipating an audience, right? There's an audience. And you had asked the question before about should you make this stuff public? And I feel like you're answering that your own question there. Like, what is the value of showing this work and having this portfolio, if not for other people to look at it and to comment on it and to write good and bad comments. So I just, I really appreciate this. This is making me think a lot. It's making me think about different ways for students definitely to show their work. And one of the things I think that is important as a critical thinker is to hear all kinds of feedback and to figure out what to do with that feedback. And so I guess I'm ending this by saying, I'm a proponent of sharing this. I'm a proponent of even if the comments are hurtful or hard to hear, I think that is the purpose of these portfolios. Otherwise, they're just scrapbooks, right, that you don't ever share. So I appreciate you helping us think about this.
You're welcome. So I'm a former poet. I used to write poems before I met my wife, and then all my poems came true. But one thing I discovered as a poet, and I mean, I did poetry readings at poetry groups. I went to schools, believe it or not, and read the kids my poems, which were not really kid friendly. I made little brochures of my poems and brought them around town so people could read them. For Christmas, for years, I literally made little books of my poetry and gave them. That was my only Christmas gift. Here's what I learned through all that. I wrote every poem just for me. It was like all for me. I needed my poems. So it's interesting when I think of my work out there, selfishly, it ain't for you. I ain't sharing it with you. It's for me, you know? And that's a weird thing. But I feel like it's okay that way, right? Like I've learned that my poems could be useful to other people. My work could be useful to other people, but really I'm terribly selfish. They're just for me and I'm doing it like, and the web I'm at a point where I think I can be a little creative, and that feels good because I need a creative outlet, right? Yeah. Okay. It is, any other comments, questions? It is exactly 11 o'clock.
Yeah, it's time for us to finish.
Okay. Yep.
You know, the only thing I'd say quickly, Todd, is that by putting this stuff out there, you're providing inspiration to other people, and that's really important. Inspiration is super important, even if it's just written for yourself. So.
Yeah, right.
All right. I'm going to go. Bye-bye. Thanks.
Bye. Yeah, see you, Ron.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Todd, for this great presentation. The recording will be posted in NWeLearn website and NWeLearn/webinars. And thank you all for coming. Thanks, Todd. Bye.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me. It's great. That was fun. Anna, we'll see you. See you later.
Yes. Yes. See you later. Take care.
Bye.